20 years' time. But right, I mean, do you know, what would you propose right now we did instead? So one question I have is, there is an API. So if you have some cool bot that's going to do all this stuff for us, you can do it, you know, you can, either you can just forget about CKAN altogether and just pull all the stuff out of it and put it in your system, or start your own instance and code it however you want. The code's all open, start, you know, mymachineinstance.ckan.net or whatever. So my question right now is, what, when your machines are going to do all of this, give me it right now and I'll use it instead. But I don't, when you say machines will do it, it's kind of, I'm not clear. It's like, what do you do instead of Debian right now? You're saying it's not working.
In my humble opinion, you should just build the infrastructure to make existing information and existing metadata more accessible to tools like that.
Right. Okay. But I mean, a lot of the time, I should probably end and move on, sorry. Okay. I'll come back. We can talk afterwards. It's been very good.
So you mentioned that we should, when we upload our databases, we should insert a license.txt there. So could you elaborate a little on what kinds of licenses are there and what is the legal foundation for them?
Right, yeah. Okay, so data licensing is an exciting and probably fairly dull topic for this audience. But the answer is Open Data Commons, which is actually a project the Open Knowledge Foundation helped, which is as a home for now, although it was started before that. Open Data Commons provides two licenses. One is a public domain license, and one is basically an attribution share-alike license. It's in fact a license that's called the Open Database License, which OpenStreetMap are actually voting about moving to from their attribute, their by share-alike. So those opendatacommons.org, there is also CC0, which is a public domain license from Creative Commons, waives everything. But those, you know, in the open source world, those are it. There's also an attribution license being drafted by Open Data Commons right now. To be frank with you, just putting, at least, even if you just put a license.txt saying, I hereby waive all rights, or I hereby waive all rights, except you better say that it was me who did this first, or whatever, is better than putting nothing. You know? It's still a license. I mean, it's not great. So that's what I'd really recommend, is just put a license.txt. You know, at best, just grab the public domain dedication license, or the open data license, opendatacommons.org, or write your own.
Rufus, thank you. I like your idea very much. And you said that you extracted out of that text file, you've written a piece of code that extracts the data and puts it into a CSV file. If that piece of code, which normally would be sitting in your machine only, if that was included to sort of convert the original file into a usable file, that would be a major step forward in my opinion. So I think making that available would be very good. The second thing is, you said linking, for example, the street names from the German zip code file to the OpenStreetMap coordinates or something requires that the naming is the same. So your dependency mechanism would identify files which have the same names for streets in both files and sort of identify files that match in that respect. That again is something that I don't see existing today and that I think your project can contribute, which is a step forward. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So the answer is, on the first point, we've done it. That is a public URL. In fact, actually, you've got to replace SVN with HG and get rid of the trunk because it's moved to Mercurial. But if you went to hg/data/bls/that, you will get the code that does the parsing. And unfortunately, this is the problem with chopping up stuff. Here is this page. And at the bottom of this page cut off is an extra field which says source. And it has information about the Mercurial repository. Because at the moment, the crudest thing we do with the data, because by the way, data changes. Particularly for government data, and this is very interesting, government data tends to get updated and changed. So for example, budget projections. And you just don't have the old version available anymore. It just gets written over. And that can be very interesting data to look at what's changed. So at the moment, we tend to cache all the data and just shove it in Mercurial or our versioning system. But we would like something better than that, because that doesn't scale for bigger files, really. We do it for only up to a megabyte, and then you get a really big Mercurial repository. Okay, sorry. One more question.
I'd like to thank you because I think it's a great idea. I had a question about the sources. I mean, there's one crucial difference between code and data. Code is self-contained. I mean, if I take the source of any program on Debian and read it, I know everything I have to know about the code. I don't care if it's written with Vim or Emacs or on Windows or Linux. I know everything. But data always refers to something real, which isn't the data, which is the object the data is describing. And that's what the method with which it was acquired makes the value of the data. And I think it's a big problem, because any archive of data is a big step, but to use it scientifically, for example, you must be sure that the it's the government that gave the unemployment figures, or it was calculated, or it was approximated by someone. And all of this is interesting, but is there any way to make really clear what was the protocol to acquire the data?
Well, okay, so you make an interesting point. So first is, you think there's this code-data distinction. I mean, it seems to me that many things you talked about at the end, like the approximation, would have been done in code, probably. And the points you have about understanding what you're doing is very important, be it for data. You know, when you use data, you need to think where it came from. But, I mean, at least I'm an economist, and I know many people who do stats and economics who maybe, you know, maybe including myself, when I'm using some stats routine someone coded into some library, I don't go and read the source code and check whether they made some misapproximation. I trust them. And you're saying there's this question of trust for data that's really crucial. And I think you're right. So one issue here is, and I don't know what the answer is, one thing is we have an author and a maintainer field. So one is, who did it, who first wrote this data, and who's kind of cleaned it up or messed around with it. So there's a distinction there. And that's one way to deal with it. I mean, ultimately, the other thing is giving out the source code. I think the point is, most data can be given out with the code that generated it, or at least prepared it, and the data itself. And that kind of refers to the previous gentleman's question. I think it's really important we give out the code as well. I don't know if that answers your question perfectly, but...
Okay.
Thank you.
Actually, I had two questions, but the first one is already partly answered. The thing is, source code is actually a kind of an opinion. Yeah? So like Firefox is a solution for a problem, and I can say I like it or don't like it, and I use another browser. But data is about truth. Yeah? And so we should look for who published the data, and do we believe him that that's the truth? Because there are agents everywhere who have an interest in defining the truth. Yeah. So this raises, in my opinion, a huge problem of authenticating the data, as well as authenticating the script that parses it.
Yeah, so I think you've asked a really good question about provenance, basically, about authority and provenance for data material. Mm. Where does it come from, and how do we verify it came from, and how do we verify it's not been changed? I don't know whether this problem is... how different it is in a really technical sense of, i.e., data's come from A to B, has it been changed? It's kind of like, has my MD5 checksum, is it still reliable? Or, you know, that kind of question. I think a deeper question is almost a social question, though, which is about how do we trust the government when they publish unemployment figures? Mm. And I have to be honest, I think there one of the biggest things is about publishing the source code. If we could see the way they do the approximations for unemployment, or the way people do climate change calculations, if that data is truly public, and at least we can authenticate it did come from this source. You know, they've got it on their website with an MD5 hash, and I can check that mine has the same MD5 hash, then I've got a pretty good hope that I've got their data. And that's the question of me being able to understand and check their data and calculations. But I think there are two things there. One is social, about our trust in institutions and our transparency of those institutions. And the other is a technical question about, literally, has data been modified between A and B in some way? I do think data is going to be more complicated in code, because people are going to do very complicated mashups. So you're going to end up with some query that you're seeing the results of on some web page that maybe is 200 databases. And then there's going to be the question of, how do I check the provenance of each of those kind of queries? How do I know someone isn't messing somewhere